May Jesus Christ be praised, now and forever. Amen. Reverend Fathers, my dear Deacon, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, on the first Sunday of Advent this year, that will be November 27th, will be introduced in the United States of America the revised English translation of the Roman Missal. This event is important in our worship. Let us reflect on some points on this event. It is a question of the English translation of the Roman Missal, revised. The history of it is this. Up to the Second Vatican Council, 1962-65, the Church in the Latin Rite celebrated only in Latin. During the Vatican II sessions, the members of the Council saw that introduction of vernacular language would be useful. So the Council permitted that the vernacular be introduced, not only in the Mass, but also the rest of the liturgy, baptism, confirmation, ordination, and so on, gradually. But very soon, the vernacular swept through so that many young people today who are 40 years old are accustomed only to Mass in English. For the Church, this is new, because 50 years is a short period for the Church. The vernacular then was introduced. A major document on how to translate was issued in 1969, which asked that dynamic equivalence be the principle followed. That means, let the translators follow more or less the sense of the Latin text. Another document in 1988 spoke on 25 years after Vatican II on some more principles. The latest document now being followed because the Church has developed experience on how to translate. Translation into the vernacular is new in the Latin Church because it's only a matter of 40 years and a little more. So the Church has learned. The bishops' conferences have learned. The office in the Vatican has learned. Mistakes made are now to be corrected. So a document was issued in 2001, 10 years ago, from Rome to say, revise all translations in the liturgy and make sure they are faithful to the original Latin. The Mass has priority because it is the liturgical act, the highest, the most frequent, and the one that touches everybody. Why revision of liturgical translations already done? Reasons are many. To be more faithful to the original Latin, with the implications, like, pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be made acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. But what we are saying up to now is, pray that our sacrifice, you may see the difference. The Latin says, my sacrifice and yours, distinguishing the ordained priest from the people of God who have baptism but not sacred ordination. Those who translated cut it out, knowingly or not knowing. Also, things like, the Lord be with you. Up to now we have been saying, and also with you. Not realizing those who did that, that the Latin said, et cum spiritu tuo, and with your spirit. The reason, because the one who said, the Lord be with you, is God's ordained minister who is officiating at a major liturgical act. And the people are replying, you minister, receive the Holy Spirit at ordination. May the Lord be with your spirit as you carry out this ministry. So now, from November 27, it will be response and with your spirit. And this is the reason, not for the sake of change, but for a serious reason, which perhaps the original translators either did not know or did not regard as important. And there are many others. Time doesn't allow us to go into them. But I have a written text which can be distributed to you afterwards. Also, so that the liturgical texts, where there is scriptural resonance, will be faithful. That is, when concepts or expressions are based on Holy Scripture, that they be reflected. For example, the prophet Malachi said, from the rising of the sun to the setting thereof, my name will be great among the Gentiles, and a proper sacrifice will be offered to my name. So, Canon 3 says that in the Latin, from the rising of the sun to the setting. But what we have been saying now is from east to west. You will say, is that not the same? Well, east, yes, is the rising of the sun, and west is the setting thereof. But the scriptural beauty, poetry, and resonance has been lost. Now it must come back. Also, the centurion said, Lord, I am not worthy that you would come under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul, my servant, will be healed. In the Mass, we say it in the Latin. But the English says, Lord, I'm not worthy to receive you, thereby putting myself at the center. I am not worthy to receive you. Whereas the centurion was very careful. Lord, I am not worthy that you would come under my roof. That comes back now. Because how we pray reflects our state of soul. And how we pray officially in the liturgy teaches us how we should pray personally. The liturgical way should form and inform our personal prayer life, like Canon 1 in the Latin. You would have to know Latin to see why. The Canon 1 says, Te igito clementissime pater, supplices te rogamus. English, which we say now, we ask you, Father, is he your brother? Is he your equal? Now we have to say, you therefore, most merciful Father, we humbly beseech you. The spirit is different. It orients us to accept that we are adoring in front of God's majesty, and we are only humble servants. Supplicesterogamus. Some of the Latin texts are difficult to translate, but effort is made. So the people of God are guaranteed that it isn't a change for the sake of change, but for very good reasons. Also, there is the Latin style, which likes repetition, through my fault, through my most grievous fault, in Latin. Those who translated didn't like that. They just said, through my fault, finish, once. Ah, no, say it three times, come on. Also, Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison, Agnus Dei, Quitolis peccata mundi, Quisedes adesa empat, 3, 3, 3. If you look at the Gloria in Excelsis Deo, you see triplets all over the place. If you look carefully, If you look at the Gloria, we generally say in the United States, is different from glory be to God in the highest in Britain, and different from another one again. The one here has cut out many things. So with a razor blade, they just cut them all out. Say, why? Now, come on, come back to the original and help us to have a more prayerful spirit. That's a reason. There are other reasons. You say, hostiam puram, hostiam sanctam, hostiam immaculata. Pure host, immaculate host, and good host. And you say, is that not repetition? What harm does repetition do to you? Sacred language. You see that flat vessel on which we put the body of Christ? We are in the liturgy, we are calling it the paten. Others want us to call it the plate. The vessel that holds the precious blood, we call it the chalice. They said, now, cup. He took the cup. Which cup? Is it tea cup or what? So we're going to say, he took the chalice. It means more to us. It's more sensitive to our spiritual piety. Also, there are other vestment. They say, dress. The priest who celebrates mass, they call him celebrant. No, they call him president. President of what? Of the Ford Foundation? Or what? Celebrant, not the president. Consubstantial with the Father. That one is much more serious and deeper. The relationship between the Father and the Son in the Credo, we now say, up to now, of one being with the Father, you would have to be a theologian to dissect it. Is that a little of Arianism, which said the Son is separate, he's not God, the Father is God there? So the church agonized over the relationship between Father and Son in the Council of Nicaea in 325, and came on with the Greek word corresponding to the Latin, consubstantial, that will return. Somebody said, but the people will not understand it. Not even one dozen cardinals understand it. Because it's the heart of the mystery of Father and Son. In any case, since when did understanding become the most important consideration in the liturgy? The worship of God is not primarily that we may understand. It is also that. The liturgy is also catechetical, but it does not become principally that we may understand. And there are other reasons. And he became man. Some woman will say, what of us? We should say he became human. The theologian comes into it. The Congregation for Doctrine of the Faith comes into it. Christ took on human nature in a distinct one individual. So it's very delicate. We cannot say he became human. He became man. And there are other reasons. And there are new masses, anyhow, that have been made in the last 20 years, 30. Let us say divine mercy. There's a votive mass for divine mercy. Beautiful. But the people haven't access to it because the translations are not made. New saints, Padre Pio, and others, so they will all come in. You will love it. The Missal, however, has 1,300 pages. The prefaces alone are 89 in the Missal as now. The Eucharistic prayers are 13. So you see, it's a much richer book than ever before. Translation, however, is a very difficult thing, and even two good scholars can disagree on how to translate a word. Two good scholars can disagree. Therefore, nobody is saying that this translation is the best possible and there's no better one. Nobody is saying that. But what we are saying is that this present translation is the work primarily of the International Committee for English in the Liturgy, ICEL, with headquarters in Washington, D.C., which is a project of 11 bishops' conferences, national, United States, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, England, Wales, Scotland, Ireland, Pakistan, South Africa, and so on. They have been working together for 40 years. In the last 10 years, they have focused on the rite of Mass, the best translation that can be produced today. Also, with cooperation from experts international and in understanding with the Congregation for Divine Worship in the Vatican City, because the liturgy, the worship of the church is something universal, is not something national. English is one of the languages spoken in very many countries in the world, so it matters very much how the Mass is celebrated in English. And I am in a position to be able to tell you that the work of the International Committee for English in the Liturgy is excellent, and that of the big languages in the world, by big, I don't mean powerful, I mean spread in many nations, English, Spanish, French, German to a certain extent, for a number of countries, Italy, because it's around where the Pope is and everybody is coming to Rome. These languages influence many other languages, including the 240 languages in Nigeria alone. So, watching then fidelity to the original Latin becomes a very difficult thing. Some individuals, without understanding, criticize. They have not studied the Latin text. They have not studied the English text. As someone says, some people can criticize standing. They won't even sit down. They haven't read the text, but they heard somebody saying that there are some people in the Vatican who are controlling the whole thing. So they said, no, nobody's going to tell us what to do. Oh, a moment. We are going to tell you what to do. Because this is the public worship of the church. But when you are at your personal prayer, then nobody's going to tell you what to do. But when you come at the altar in the name of Holy Mother Church, the church is going to tell you what to do. You are not allowed to add one word, not to subtract one word, even if you are a bishop or even half a dozen cardinals. They can't. If we are to add even one word to the Mass, the whole thing must go through the Congregation for Divine Worship and end up on the Pope's table. And he has to approve it. Otherwise, it is wild liturgy. So a greater guarantee the people of God cannot have in this world of ours. I could go on, but there is no need. When you read the text written, you will see many arguments then in greater detail. The assurance is that as the law of prayer, the law of faith go hand in hand, that is, how the church prays should manifest what the church believes. And how we pray influences our personal prayer. Therefore, the texts we use in the liturgy are of great importance. That is why the celebrant is not allowed to add or to subtract. But when you are at a private prayer, then you are free. We thank the Lord Jesus who gave us the church, which is Catholic and one, and also which has guardian, the bishop at the diocesan level, the Holy Father at the universal level. We beg the Lord to help us that as we pray, so we may grow in faith and also in personal prayer. To him be honor and glory forever and ever.